Okay. Thank you. This is another day, and we really appreciate that you've come one more time to Sign Language Resource Center, Dhaka, where sign language matters. And as we always say, that with sign language, we are equal. And that's why today, one more time, we have gathered together, and we want to share with you something today in a very short time. And I hope that you're going to learn something new. As you can see from my background, we are in a classroom setup. That's a blackboard. I don't know when you last saw a blackboard. We also have a piece of white chalk. I don't know when you last saw somebody writing on a blackboard with a white chalk or any piece of chalk. But today we are there, and that's what we are going to do. And we are going to speak on something. And this is a bit theoretical, just on sign language. And today we are going to discuss something on elements of a sign. We are going to discuss the elements of a sign. And when we talk of the elements of a sign, it is important for us to note that when we talk of elements, we are talking of composition. Or what does each particular sign have? What does each particular sign, or what is involved in composing one particular sign? So we are going to talk on the elements of one particular sign. And we are going to talk of what composes one sign, and that's what we are calling the elements. They are usually four, but I usually add the fifth one, because the fifth one is very, very important also. But they are basically four, and there are four of them. If you remove one of them, or if you change one of them, whatever you could have been doing may change the meaning. And for us to be able to remember what that means, I choose to use an acronym. And the acronym is going to help us to understand the elements of a sign. And therefore, that's why we have the blackboard here. And I want to write the four of them. I want to write number 1, 2, 3, 4. The fifth one, I'm not going to number it, but I'm going to leave it there for you. And I want to write it down so that you don't forget. And the fifth element of a sign is what we call use, I hope you can see there, of non-manual features. And sometimes what we said, when we talk of non-manual features or signs, that would also be called signs, sorry. It could also be called markers. So if you have somebody saying non-manual signs, non-manual features, non-manual markers, they could all be pointing to the same thing, to one thing. And the other form, we are going to use an acronym, which is, we usually call HOAM, H-O-A-M. And when we talk of HOAM, and go to that if you're in sign language area, I usually challenge people to keep remembering HOAM. You should not forget about HOAM. And H stands for hardship. O is orientation. And orientation is also direction. You can call that direction. I'll explain. Articulation. Oh, sorry, A is articulation, stands for articulation, which is place of. And finally we have M, which stands for movement. Mm-hmm. We have those four: hardship, orientation or direction, place of articulation, and movement. I want us to remember that every single sign for it to have meaning in sign language, then it usually has the form. The first one we have said is hardship. And hardship is formed on our hearts, as the name is suggesting, hardship. And one of the hardships, or an example of the hardships, is the letters of the alphabets. We have 26 alphabets in sign language, and all of them are formed on our hearts. So we can say to them that A is a hardship, and there are signs that we make using that hardship, like which, like any, like other. You can see we have B hardship. This one is B hardship, and you use it like when you're signing BC. We use the B hardship. We have C hardship, like when you're signing church. That's C hardship. And we continue with D, E, like example, up to Z. And Zenda is a zigzag movement, like the way we use it when signing writing. Mm-hmm. So it is important to know that we have those 26 hardships, and we have others which are beyond the 26, like the claw hardship. The claw hardship, you can see the claw. And an example of a sign using the claw hardship is mix or integrate, confuse, rain. Those are examples of claw hardships. We also have others like V. Curved V, like we also have curved B, as I had said before, like this. There are quite a number of hardships, and it is important to know that each hardship may represent something different. And when you change the hardship, that sign will definitely change its meaning. The other one is orientation or direction of the hardship, which you've spoken there a lot. Each hardship has a particular direction. Of importance to us today is to note that when we refer to direction, it is in relation to the person who is signing. So we can say it's pointing away from the signer, or to the left of the signer, or to the right of the signer, or in front of the signer. So when you're talking of orientation or direction, where is the hardship facing in relation to the person who is signing? Like this is H and this is U. If I were to describe the two, where is the hardship facing in relation to me who is signing? When I turn it and it turns towards you, how do I describe that? And you can see how it is changing meaning. When you change the direction, you change the meaning. I want to give an example of a very simple sign, which is me, so that you can see it could have the same hardship, but changing the direction changes the meaning. How do we sign you? You, we sign it like this. You. Or you. The hardship, we call it extended index finger. Extended index finger. And when you're signing you, the finger or the index finger is pointing away from me, the signer. and that becomes you. If I changed the direction of that sign and I pointed the extended index finger towards me, it changes meaning and it becomes me. So before I had done this, it was you, and now I do this, it becomes me. That is the importance of orientation, which we are calling direction. The other one is phrase of articulation. Phrase of articulation is where is the sign formed. I want to remind ourselves today that there's what we call the signing space. The signing space is an imaginary area, maybe it can go to the highest you can go, raising your heart, and maybe wide to where your heart can be able to spread, and down to your waist, not below your waist. So this could be my signing area today. And within the signing area is where we do all our signs. And when we are signing, where do we place those signs to give them meaning? There are signs on different parts of our bodies. There are some which could be on the head, others on the forehead, others on the nose, others on the chest, on the stomach, on the shoulders. There are so many areas. I want to give an example of a sign formed on the forehead. One, because all forget. Hope you get that, you know that. The other sign can be on your nose, like Sudan. Others could be on your cheek, like nice on the dishes. Nice. Yeah. And I want to show you something using that or sign nice. Because I said the place of articulation where you are signing is very important and may change the meaning of a particular sign. So when we do nice, okay, we do the sign here, that is nice. If we change the place of articulation and we do it the same way, the heart shape is the same, the movement is the same, we are not changing the place of articulation, and we do it from here, from this point, this becomes clever. So it is basically like the same, but when it is here it's nice, when it comes here it is clever. So it is good to know that if you change the place of articulation, if you change where the sign has to be signed or need to be signed, then it changes the meaning or loses the meaning altogether. So as I have said there before, there are also signs which are done on the shoulder, like responsibility. There is others done on the chest, like please or sorry. That one we many of us maybe know. Others are done on the stomach, like full, satisfied. And when you come to class, we are going to teach you more of this. But for today, I want you to remember the elements of a sign, and we are now to the fourth one, which is movement. And when we talk of movement, we are talking of either the direction of the movement or the frequency of the movement. If you change any of those, it definitely changes the meaning. We can also use movement and frequency of movement to show plural forms. Like you can do house once, and when you do twice, it becomes houses. So it's good to remember that if you change the movement, either the frequency, direction, it may change the meaning of that particular sign. Then, these four are combined together to make one particular sign. There is no sign without these four elements. And I want you to remember that. Then when you form the sign, for it to get the true meaning, or for it to convey the intended meaning, then we need to use the fifth one, which I said I did not number, which we call the use of non-manual features, facial expressions, body movement, and such. So if you are going to be a good signer, if you're going to excel in sign language, then you need to remember Ho'am, which is hardship, direction or orientation, breath of articulation, movement, and finally, remember to use the non-manual features or signs. And that's what we do in sign language. We do not just blow hearts. There are some guys who would say that the sign language guys or the deaf people, they just throw hearts like this in the air and then somehow they are communicating. No hearts are thrown into the air. Nobody throws their hearts aimlessly. They are using a formatted thing, a program thing, which is sign language. And it's important for you to learn these things. It's important for you to understand them, so that in future, you'll be a good sign language interpreter. In future, you'll be able to communicate freely and comfortably with any deaf person. And we want to thank you one more time for visiting Sign Language Resource Center, VICA. And what do we say? With sign language, we are equal and we welcome you. Continue getting these videos from us. Continue sharing them to your friends or with your friends. Share them. Let the people see. Let people learn together with you. And remember, the best way to get updates from our channel, Sign Language Resource Center, is through subscribing. Kindly hit the subscribe button down there, and then you'll be alerted when we upload any new material on our channel. Thank you so much. Wow, we are good to go.